In part 2 of this lecture series, I discussed in detail the preparation of a 10-column worksheet, which is step number 5 of the accounting cycle. On the basis of these adjustments columns of the worksheet, the next step is to journalize the adjusting entries, after which your journal sheet would look like this. Please note the date of the adjusting entries, the last day or end of the accounting period. In this problem, December 31, 2019. For easier referencing later on, it is advisable to write the adjustment letters. And of course, you will need to post these adjusting entries to their appropriate account ledgers, to the very same ledgers used in step 3 when the journal entries were classified or posted. Meaning, you do not have to create another set of T accounts or account ledgers. But in case you do not have a ledger yet for a particular account, because let's say that account name was not used in previous journal entries, then just make a ledger for that account right after the last account ledger you have. And please be reminded that after posting the adjusting entries to the ledger, and that includes writing all the required information in the ledger, do not forget to fill up this PR column of your journal sheet where your adjustments are recorded. What will you write under the PR column of your journal? The account number. As I said in part 1 of this accounting cycle video series, the main focus of my lecture on the topic is the preparation of worksheet in part 2 and closing entries as well as reversing entries in this part 3. The other steps in the accounting cycle deserve their own separate lecture series, so I will not elaborate much the classifying or posting procedure here. However, after discussing reversing entries, I will show you how an account ledger should look like after posting the journal entries as well as the adjusting, closing, and reversing entries. Anyway, after posting the accounts in the adjusting entries and extracting the ledger balances must reflect these amounts in the adjusted trial balance columns of the worksheet. And based on these columns, step number 7 then is the preparation of the adjusted trial balance. In doing so, it is advisable to use a 2-column journal sheet for classroom purposes because just like journal entries, only 2 money columns are needed for the adjusted trial balance. Then comes step 8, the preparation of financial statements. First, of course, is the income statement. Needless to say, with notes to financial statements based on the income statement columns of this worksheet. Then, the statement of changes in owner's equity or capital statement. Since in this problem, there is no mention of the amount of capital on January 1, 2019 and any additional investment made during the year 2019, then it follows that this Benipayo capital amounting to 1,296,900 is the capital at the beginning of 2019 and there is no additional investment. Another account needed in the statement of changes in owner's equity is the drawings, which can be found here under the debit column of the statement of financial position. With the capital on December 31, 2019, appearing in the statement of changes in owner's equity, the statement of financial position can then be made, again, with properly presented notes to financial statements. Next, after the financial statements, is the closing entries, the purpose of which is to bring each nominal or temporary account to zero balance by transferring them to the owner's equity account. As discussed in part 1 of my lecture videos on adjusting entries, the nominal or temporary accounts are the income statement accounts, meaning those accounts which can be found in the income statement or statement of comprehensive income, plus the owner's withdrawal or drawing account. Therefore, in doing the closing entries, we need to refer to the income statement columns of the worksheet, as well as to the drawing account under the statement of financial position or balance sheet debit column. There are actually 4 closing entries. The first one concerns all income statement accounts with credit balances. So, we have to look at this credit column and debit each account with an amount written on this column, except the income summary account. The first figure is this 2,400,000, which is the balance of the sales account. Since this amount is a credit balance, to close it, we have to debit the account name sales for the amount of 2,400,000. Then likewise, we have to debit for 17,500 the account name, purchase returns, and allowances. In addition, this 6,500 must be debited also using the account name, purchase discounts, and this interest income account in the amount of 9,375. And of course, since closing entries are considered journal entries, being recorded also in the journal, the total debit must equal the total credit. Having debited sales, purchase returns and allowances, purchase discounts, and interest income, our credit should be to the income summary account for the total of these 4 figures, amounting to 2,433,375. We can explain this entry with the words to close nominal accounts in the income statement with credit balances. Please note the date of closing entries, the end of an accounting period. In this particular problem, December 31, 2019. Then, just like adjusting entries, it is advisable to number the closing entries for easier referencing later on. The second closing entry is with regards to those accounts under the debit column of the income statement, starting with this 455,000 worth of merchandise inventory beginning. Remember, I pointed out in part 2 that this is the beginning balance. Because this has a debit balance, to close it, we have to credit merchandise inventory beginning for 455,000. After that, credit also 40,000. Sales returns and allowances. And likewise, credit these sales discounts for 10,500 and so on and so forth up to this last amount of 5,000 under the debit column of the income statement. But what must be the debited account of this second closing entry? Income summary for the total of all the credited accounts. In this case, 2,540,837.50. For the explanation, to close nominal accounts in the income statement with debit balances. And please notice that in writing an explanation for an entry in the journal, you may use 2 or more rows, just so your explanation will not occupy the PR or money columns. As for the date, since this second closing entry must also be made on December 31, it should not be written again because we already have that date up here for the first closing entry. You only need to write the same date again when you begin a new journal page. The third closing entry is to close the balance of the income summary account, which must be equal to the net income or net loss, as the case may be, to the owner's capital account. You may just look at your 10-column worksheet for the amount of the net income or net loss. Here, amounting to 137,537.50. But of course, you can double check if this is indeed the balance of the income summary account. Remember that in the last adjusting entry to record merchandise inventory end, we credited income summary for 245,000. And then here in our first closing entry, we again credited the same income summary account for 2,433,375. And finally, in our second closing entry, we debited income summary for 2,540,837.50. When those three figures are posted to the income summary ledger, the balance would be 137,537.50, which is the exact amount of the net income in the 10-column worksheet, and of course, in your income statement. Because there is net income, in contrast with net loss, the balance of this income summary account is credit, as you can see here. To close this account, what must be done? Debit it. So, debit income summary for 137,537.50 and credit Benipayo Capital for the same amount. Notice the effect of this closing entry on the capital of the owner. The capital increased because it is credited. That's why you learned long ago that net income increases the capital account. And that in the statement of changes in owner's equity or capital statement, the net income is shown as an addition to the beginning balance of capital. For the explanation, we may write something like to close net income to capital or to close the income summary account to the owner's capital account. And the fourth and last closing entry is with regards to the drawing account, which is also close to the owner's capital account. The drawing account here, amounting to 35,000, is on the debit column of the statement of financial position, which means it has a debit balance. Therefore, to close this balance of Benipayo drawing, we have to credit it and debit Benipayo Capital for 35,000. Explanation: to close drawings to capital. To recap, there are four closing entries. First, the revenue and contra expense or contra purchases accounts in the income statement, all of which have credit balances, are debited according to their respective account balances. And then, the income summary is credited for the total amount. Second, the expense and contra revenue or contra sales accounts in the income statement, all of which have debit balances, are credited at their respective account balances. And the income summary account is debited for an amount equal to the total of those nominal accounts. Third, the balance of income summary after the second closing entry, which must be equal to the net income or net loss, must be close to capital. If there is net income, the income summary account has a credit balance. So to close, that income summary account must be debited with a corresponding credit to owner's capital. Conversely, in case of loss, the income summary account has a debit balance, and therefore, in order to close it, it must be credited with a debit to capital. Fourth, the drawing account, which normally has a debit balance, is credited for the full amount of its balance in order to close it with a debit to the owner's capital account. So you see, all the nominal or temporary accounts are eventually closed to the capital account. Their balances at the end of an accounting period are not carried over to the next period, but instead become zero after the closing entries. On the first day of the next accounting period, accountants have the option to perform what is called reversing entries. I said option because, as discussed in part 1 of this video series, reversing entries are not mandatory. The idea behind these entries is to cancel out certain adjusting entries, namely, number 1, the accrued expense, number 2, accrued income, number 3, prepaid expense or deferred expense, when the expense method was used in recording the advance payment, and number 4, unearned or deferred income, when the income method was used in recording the advance collection. For consistency in the accounting procedure of recording income and expenses. From the term reversing entries, we just have to reverse these 4 mentioned adjusting entries. The other types of adjustments not mentioned here must not be reversed. Again, let me stress the types of adjustments that may be reversed. Number 1, accrued expense. Number 2, accrued income. So, both accrual adjustments may be reversed. Number 3, prepaid expense or deferred expense, when the expense method was used in recording the prepayment. In other words, if the asset method was used, the adjusting entry concerning prepaid expense must not be reversed. And number 4, unearned or deferred income, when the income method was used in recording the advance collection. Meaning, if the liability method was used, no reversing entry may be made. Having discussed that, let us take a look at our adjusting entries on December 31, 2019 for Benipayo General Merchandising and determine which of these adjusting entries may be reversed. Letter A, adjustment with a debit to office supplies and a credit to supplies expense. What type of adjusting entry is this? Prepaid expense, because office supplies were purchased and paid for prior to use. There was advance payment and therefore this is a prepaid expense or deferred expense adjustment. But remember, prepayment can be recorded by using either the asset method or the expense method. The question is, what method was used to record the advance payment? Expense method. How did we know? Because here, in our adjusting entry, we credited supplies expense, which means that this account, supplies expense, had been debited upon payment for the supplies. Remember, in my video about this type of adjustment, when upon advance payment, an asset account was debited, in the adjusting entry, that asset account must be credited. But when an expense account was instead debited to record the prepayment, then in the adjustment, that expense account must be credited. Since here in letter A adjustment, the account supplies expense is credited, that means this expense account was debited upon prepayment, and hence the expense method was used. So, if this adjusting entry is regarding prepaid expense under the expense method, may this adjustment be reversed? Yes, because it is one of the 4 types of adjustments stated here. prepaid expense or deferred expense under the expense method. To reverse, the debited account office supplies in the adjusting entry has to be credited, while the credited account supplies expense needs to be debited for the same amount of 3,500. Letter B, adjusting entry now. What type of adjustment is this? Depreciation. May this be reversed? No, because it is not one of the four types mentioned earlier, right? Third, adjusting entry. What type of adjustment is this? Prepaid expense, of course. Having one account named prepaid insurance. But what method was used to record the advance payment? Asset method. Because prepaid insurance, which is an asset account, is credited here. Which means this very same account was debited upon prepayment. So prepaid expense under asset method. May this be reversed? No, because only expense method of prepayment is allowed to be reversed. Letter D, adjustment now. A debit to interest receivable and a credit to interest income. So, what type of adjustment do we have here? There is receivable and income. Therefore, this is uncollected income. Income already earned but not yet collected, which is what? Accrued income. May this kind of adjustment be reversed? Yes, accruals may be reversed, whether accrued income or accrued expense. So to reverse, debit what was credited in the adjustment, which is interest income, and credit what was debited, which is interest receivable for the amount of 1,125. That's why we have this second reversing entry. Next, letter E. What type of adjusting entry is this? With a debit to an expense account and a credit to a payable account. Accrued expense, meaning expense already incurred. That's why the debit to an expense account, but not yet paid. That's why the credit to a liability account. Again, accrual may be reversed. So debit, salaries payable, and credit, salaries expense for 100,000. That is our third reversing entry. Letter F, adjustment, is about bad debts expense, which is not among the four mentioned types of adjusting entries allowed to be reversed. So, on to letter G now. Notice, this is very similar to letter E. Because this is also accrued expense. So, we may reverse this. How do we reverse? Debit, rent payable, and credit, rent expense for 30,000. That is now our fourth reversing entry. Next, letter H. Accrued expense again, right? So, reverse this also. Debit, interest payable, and credit, interest expense for 1,312.50. Finally, adjustment letter I. This is about merchandise inventory at the end per physical count, which is not to be reversed. Just like in my other videos, I will teach you an easier way to determine if a certain adjusting entry may be reversed. If an adjustment increased either an asset account except with regards to merchandise inventory end, or a liability account, then that adjusting entry may be reversed. Otherwise, it must never be reversed. Let's take a look at these adjusting entries. Notice, this first one has a debit to office supplies, causing an increase in the asset account office supplies. Therefore, according to the tip I just gave you, this letter A adjustment may be reversed. Which else increased either an asset or a liability? Letter B, did not. Letter C, did not also. Letter D, adjustment, did increase the asset interest receivable. So, this adjusting entry may be reversed. This one, increased the liability account salaries payable. Because this salaries payable is credited here. In short, this adjustment may also be reversed. This letter F adjustment neither increased an asset nor a liability account. So, this one must not be reversed. Adjusting entries G and H may be reversed because they both increased liability. This adjusting entry to record the merchandise inventory end per physical count increased asset, but as stated here, is an exception. So, the adjusting entry regarding merchandise inventory end must not be reversed. And so, we have 5 reversing entries here. Now, let me explain briefly the mentioned purpose of reversing entries here. For consistency in the accounting procedure of recording income and expenses. As an example, what is the usual entry to record the payment of expense? Debit the expense account. Okay? Debit the expense account and credit cash, right? Now, let's say we did not prepare a reversing entry for this adjustment letter E. Upon the eventual payment of these salaries, will it be correct to make the usual debit to salaries expense? Of course not. Otherwise, salaries expense would have been recorded twice. In addition, the liability account salaries payable would not be eliminated. In other words, if no reversing entry was made for this adjustment, upon payment of this 100,000 pesos worth of salaries to the employees, the debit must be to the account salaries payable, not to the usual salaries expense. But if a reversing entry was made, the account salaries payable would have been eliminated so that upon payment of the salaries to the employees, salaries expense may then be debited. And let me remind you of what I mentioned in part 1 of this lecture series. When these reversing entries are made, posting to the ledger must follow. Then, the accounting cycle starts again with the collection and analysis of data followed by recording of transactions and so on and so forth. Because like all other so-called cycles, the accounting cycle is regularly repeated all over again in the same order. Now, as promised earlier, I will show you how an account ledger should look like after posting the journal entries as well as the adjusting, closing, and reversing entries. Let's take salaries expense for that purpose. Here, in the unadjusted trial balance columns of the worksheet, salaries expense has a balance of 1,100,000. how did this amount came to be? From the postings of the journal entries involving this account since January 2019 up to the end of November of the same year. Assuming salaries were paid on a monthly basis, then the salaries expense ledger should have looked like this as of the end of November. Monthly salaries of 100,000 accrued at the end of each month from January to November 2019 for a total of 1,100,000 for the 11-month period ending November 30, 2019. Since this amount is the balance forwarded in the unadjusted trial balance, it should be double ruled. Of course, the PR, meaning posting reference or folio of the ledger, is where the source of the information posted here should be written. Since these are all from journal entries recorded in the general journal, so under the PR column, write GJ, which means general journal, and the page number of the general journal where the respective journal entries were recorded. Now, recall that one of the adjustments on December 31, 2019 involves a debit to salaries expense for 100,000. After posting, the salaries expense ledger would have appeared like this. On the PR column, you may write AE, meaning adjusting entry, and then the letter of the adjusting entry. Or, just like the previous postings, you may write GJ and the page number. Because keep in mind that adjusting entries as well as closing entries and reversing entries are likewise recorded in the general journal. 1,100,000 debit balance on November 30 and 100,000 debit for the month of December. So same side. And therefore, we have to add 1,100,000 plus 100,000 for an adjusted total of 1,200,000 salaries expense, which must appear in the adjusted trial balance. And don't forget, double rule again, because this is a balance. And recall also that this salaries expense totaling 1,200,000 being a nominal account was closed on December 31. After posting, the salaries expense ledger would look like this. CE2 stands for closing entry number 2. Of course, you may write GJ here and the page number where your closing entry number 2 was written. But if you do that, it is advisable to write under the particulars column the words closing entry or closing entry number 2. 1,200,000 adjusted debit balance after posting the adjusting entry and credit posting of the same amount due to the closing entry equals zero balance at the end of 2019 because salaries expense is one of the nominal or temporary accounts. The following day, January 1, didn't we prepare a reversing entry involving the accrued salaries expense? Yes, we did here. When this reversing entry is posted to the ledger, the updated look of the salaries expense ledger is this. Again, if you choose to write GJ and page number here on the PR column, better write reversing entry under the particulars column. One more account ledger I'd like to emphasize is that of merchandise inventory. Remember, there are two merchandise inventory accounts, the beginning and the end. Do we need to make separate ledgers for those two? No, we don't have to. Meaning, we may post the debit to merchandise inventory end, which was made in one of the adjusting entries, to the same ledger account, where the posting to the merchandise inventory beginning had been made. The merchandise inventory ledger would then appear like this. Please note that these two figures need not be added, because the total would not mean anything. This is the merchandise inventory end for 2018, which became the merchandise inventory beginning for 2019, while this one is the merchandise inventory end for 2019. In the financial statements of 2019, this merchandise inventory beginning was forwarded to the income statement, whereas this merchandise inventory end appeared in the statement of financial position as of December 31, 2019. Remember? Therefore, these two figures do not have to be added in the ledger. This merchandise inventory ledger would then be updated to appear like this after posting the closing entry involving the merchandise inventory beginning. Once again, thank you for watching.